Hello there, and welcome. My name's Andy Compton, and I can't tell you how excited I am that you've decided to take the time to take this course. It's great. It's my great pleasure to be your host and your presenter for this course entitled Divine Principle Internal Guidance 101, meaning we're going to deal with the basic points of internal guidance. My Path of Restoration. In this session, session number one, we're going to do a review of the Divine Principle. This course was created for those who've studied the Divine Principle and would like guidance as to how they can apply the Divine Principle to their lives. I believe you're going to find this course to be both exciting and rewarding. It's good to study the truth, but nothing can compare to what we experience when we put the truth into practice. The fact that you're taking this course means that at least on some basic level, you have an understanding of the main points contained within the Divine Principle. And most likely, you are asking the questions, what's next? Where do I go from here? So the purpose of this seminar is to help answer those questions. But first, as was mentioned, we are going to do a review. It's important that we have a clear understanding of the key points contained within the Divine Principle before we go about trying to apply it. That makes sense, right? As you know, the Divine Principle has three major parts: the ideal of creation, the human fall, and restoration. So let's start with God's ideal of creation. God's ideal begins with God, the absolute original being, the source of all existence. God's most essential nature is heart. He is our heavenly parent who invested everything in order to create the cosmos in which we live. His creation includes both the physical universe and the spiritual universe. His reason for creating was to what? He wanted to be able to experience the deepest and most beautiful relationships of love as a substantial reality. And through those relationships, experience the greatest joy. When his creation was ready, he brought forth his beloved children, his son and his daughter. In the Bible, they give them the names Adam and Eve. He created them in his image. Although we use he when we speak about God, in reality, we should always keep in mind that within God, there is both the Father God and there is the Mother God. God has both natures, Father and Mother. When God created our first ancestors, he did not only create their physical bodies, which are quite incredible, but more importantly, he gave them each an eternal spirit, a spirit self, and a heart that has the capability to grow and become fully one with his heart. Heart, which is a source of love, is special. It contains the element of freedom and the responsibility of ownership. It is not controlled by the laws and the principles that govern God's creation, and therefore, it possesses the potential for going in either a good or evil direction, towards God or away from God. God gave Adam and Eve responsibility for their hearts because he wanted them to share in his work of creation and by fulfilling their responsibility for love, stand as his true son and daughter, in whom he could fully dwell. In addition, knowing that love had the potential for going in both a good and an evil direction, God gave them guidance concerning love. We see this guidance expressed in the Bible, both in the three blessings that are recorded in Genesis 1:28, to be fruitful, multiply, and have dominion. In other words, to become a true person first before engaging in sexual romantic love and having children, and then taking the position as lords of creation, having dominion. And God also gave the commandment in Genesis 2:17, Do not eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, or you will die. In other words, God was telling them, do not engage in the romantic sexual love before you are ready, before I give you the blessing of marriage. This was a guidance Adam and Eve needed to follow in order to fulfill the responsibility God had given them concerning love. If they had kept God's guidance, their hearts would have matured to the point of being in perfect resonance with God. That's when God would have acknowledged Adam and Eve as his true son and his true daughter. This would have been the fulfillment of God's first blessing, to be fruitful. In that state of oneness with God, nothing, no temptation, would ever be able to separate them from God. Having fulfilled the first blessing, Adam and Eve would have been qualified to partake in the second blessing, to multiply. For this, God intended to bless Adam and Eve in marriage as husband and wife. He wanted them to experience the joy of romantic sexual union, as well as the joy that comes from giving birth to children and become parents. By having children, Adam and Eve were to establish the family in which, through the relationships of husband and wife, parents and children, brothers and sisters, God's love would be fully present. And from that point onward, from generation to generation, God would have dwelt with all of his children, each one of them a unique expression of his character. If this had happened, all humanity would have lived as one family, recognizing Adam and Eve as their one original true parents. Next, having fulfilled the first two blessings, God intended to bestow upon his children the third blessing, to have dominion. God's desire was to experience and have dominion over his creation through his children, loving, respecting, maintaining, caring for, creatively developing, and appreciating all of his creation. If this had happened, all people would now be living as members of God's family, and all people would be living lives filled with joy, lives that would be true, would be good and beautiful, and would be prosperous. This would be the kingdom of God. Doesn't that sound beautiful? I look forward to the fulfillment of that ideal. And it would not only have existed on this earth. When our physical lives end, we are to enter our eternal home, the spiritual world, and live there as couples in God's eternal dominion of true love. The Korean expression Father and Mother Moon use for this kingdom of God is Chun Il-guk. So, there you have it. That's a summary of God's ideal of creation. Next is the human fall. As we all know, the world we live in today is far from God's ideal. The archangel Lucifer, feeling a lack of love, pursued a path that was guided by his self-centered desires. This led him to tempt Eve, and Eve, even though she had received God's guidance concerning love, chose to listen to the archangel's words and ultimately allowed herself to be seduced into a fallen relationship of love. This is how the archangel became Satan and Eve became fallen Eve. Then, with the fallen love that she received, she went to Adam and tempted him to engage with her in a relationship of love. This revelation concerning the human fall that God revealed through Father Moon is one of the most important revelations God has ever given to humanity. It means the family from which all of humanity was born, which includes each one of us, was not God's family. We were not born as descendants of God's love. Instead, we were born into the family that came into being through the love that was initiated by the archangel. It was a love based on lies, on lust, on self-centered desires, on arrogance, and on disobedience to God. This is how we were cut off from God. This is what broke God's heart, and this is why humanity fell into a state of spiritual death. And this is how the world became a living hell. Here's a quote from Father Moon. It is false love, false life, and false lineage that have infested the earth. God's love, life, and lineage fell into the hands of the adulterer Satan, the enemy of love. Heaven and earth were suffocated and transformed into hell. The world became a wretched place far from God's presence. Yet, to this day, people live in ignorance of this. People are deluded into believing that the lineage of the enemy is the lifeline upon which the world depends. This is the wretched truth about humankind, who are descended from the fall. That is why we refer to this world as hell on earth. God views humanity's tragic situation with a heart full of pain. These words express the human tragedy that resulted from the fall. Now, let's move on to restoration. Having revealed the ideal God originally intended, and having revealed the fall that twisted God's ideal into a nightmare, the divine principle reveals something quite amazing. It reveals God's plan of restoration. Restoration is the key to finding our way back from this living hell to the realization of God's ideal of creation. What we call in Korean, as it was mentioned earlier, Chun Il-guk, the world God originally intended. In fact, every person, whether they know it or not, is on their path of restoration. The problem is that most people, if they are moving on this path at all, are moving in the wrong direction. This is because we are all born into this sinful world, separated from God, and we are dominated by our fallen nature. And most critically, we are ignorant of the most fundamental truths, including God's plan for restoration. It is because of this ignorance that we, without realizing it, have been moving further and further away from God. We are like a boat on a river that is flowing away from God, headed towards an ocean of death. To get closer to God, we need to go up the river. But in order for us to move upriver against the current, we must know the path of restoration, and we must apply our sincere effort in order to progress on that path. Even if we want to just maintain our present spiritual position, it requires effort. Without it, the current of the river will naturally take us downstream. To understand God's principles of restoration, and then to apply those principles to our personal path so that we can move up the river, that is what this course is all about. The divine principle reveals to us how, through the course of history, God has been applying his principle of restoration. In Adam's family, in Noah's family, in Abraham's family, with Moses and the Israelites, at the time of the kings, in the age of the prophets, and with John the Baptist, and with Jesus. He has done this for one reason, by showing us how he has put his principles of restoration to work in history. He wanted to give us the confidence to believe in those principles and to put them into practice in our own lives. God would like to hear us say, "Wow, this divine principle theory on restoration, it's not just a theory. It really is God's plan for restoration, not only for the central figures of the past, but for my life as well." This is why this course is so important. Its purpose is to help each of us apply God's plan for restoration to our own lives. In addition, we are going to point out the many mistakes and failures in the providence. By recognizing and learning from the mistakes of the past, we can avoid making those same mistakes. Having said that, let's take a moment to review the main points regarding restoration. So, point number one, fallen people need to first move themselves away from Satan and closer to God. This can be accomplished when people make good conditions that reverse the mistakes that were made in the fall of the first family. That makes sense, right? Okay, so the divine principle calls these conditions of indemnity. Examples of indemnity conditions, to mention just a few, are Abel's offering to God. When Noah built the ark, that was an offering, condition of indemnity. When Abraham offered his son Isaac. Or in the case of Moses, when he offered 40 days of fasting before he received the Ten Commandments. And in the case of Jesus, when Jesus offered 40-day fasting before he began his public mission. Number two, when we fulfill such conditions, this creates a foundation upon which God can send the new Adam and the new Eve, the Messiah and his bride. Point number three, if that foundation fulfills its purpose and the Messiah and his bride are received, then the Messiah and his bride will be able to restore the failure of Adam and Eve and receive God's blessing on their marriage. In doing so, they will stand as the true parents of all humankind, and their family will stand as God's family, and their lineage as God's lineage. Point number four. When people make the choice to unite in heart with the true parents can then bestow God's blessing on their marriages, allowing them to be reborn into God's family and become engrafted into God's lineage. Number five, after becoming members of God's family, couples must work hard to remove their fallen nature and to grow their hearts to become one with God's heart. In doing so, over time, they will gradually come to stand as God's true sons and daughters and be qualified to become true parents and lords of creation in their own right. Point number six, as God's children, we will join with God and true parents in loving all people, helping all people to come back home and be restored to God's family. And then, point number seven. When all the work is done, God, the true parents, and all humanity, we're going to take a vacation and we're going to celebrate. We will celebrate the end of restoration and the complete fulfillment of God's ideal of true love. I'm looking forward to that, aren't you? I hope we can all be there together. So that's it. That concludes our review of the key points of the divine principle. God's ideal, the human fall, and restoration. I hope it was helpful. Going forward from here, the task we each are faced with is to understand how we can successfully apply the principle to our personal path of restoration. In the next three sessions, okay, we're going to go over several topics that will help prepare us for our journey. They will include motivation, our confidence in the divine principle, and how to deal with discouragement. So that concludes this session. Keep well. I look forward to seeing you in session number two.